20 years ago, I lived in peace. Well, relative peace. It was a commune, after all. No, it wasn't a religious commune, but rather a communal living experiment called Esalen, the Esalen Institute in Big Sur, for those of you who are familiar with it. Esalen was founded in the 1960s as a center to develop your mind, body, and spirit. Almost everyone who works there lives there in shared housing and shares rooms. And everyone through their work and intention contributes to creating a utopian community of sorts, tucked away from the world. The goal is to have clear communication, to work through any differences you might have with anyone, and residents are coached to seek and encourage everyone's wholeness and authenticity so that the community as a whole can bask in a feeling of mutual love, growth, and respect. Every meeting starts with a check-in. We go around in a circle and share from our heart how we were doing. It gave each of us an opportunity to clear things with others in the group. Now, as you might imagine, living in such close quarters with others can bring up some stuff between people. It's like we're all siblings, and as much as we might love and respect each other, we also trigger each other some of the time. So every mealtime is an opportunity to process difficult feelings with one another and to live with authenticity and aim for a loving community. During my first few months there, this seemed like a magical place, like living a utopian dream. But after working there a while, the blush of idealism started to wear off. I saw the reality and the hard work of living in community. It couldn't reach its ideals at every moment. I wanted to keep showing up as my best self with others, my most ideal self, but as time went by, it was hard to do so when I got tired or cranky. Yes, I do get cranky. Being human is challenging, after all. And feeling tired when you live and work in community can be difficult. There's nowhere to hide. Struggling with life's issues around relationships, survival, life aspirations, depression, love, illness, and so forth can be challenging. So no matter how good the intentions, these very human struggles impact even the most loving of communities. It's just the very nature of being human. I still think fondly of my time at Esalen and particularly cherish the conscious effort that people made to be more loving. I remembered my time there as I started reflecting on Martin Luther King Jr. and his dream of creating beloved community on earth. And I began to wonder about the obstacles to achieving that. When Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated at the tender age of 39, standing on his balcony of his motel room in Memphis, Tennessee, he'd only been politically active for 13 years. Yet what an impact he made in such a short time. Perhaps you wonder, as I do, what he might have done had he lived longer. A man so powerful, so wise, so eloquent, so committed to his vision of nonviolence, love, justice, and equity for all. His message of nonviolence probably saved thousands of lives. His hope, his persistence, and his courage changed the course of racial justice in this country. It laid the foundation for truly living The Declaration of Independence's assertion that all men are created equal, and I would say all human beings are created equal. Now, we've come a long way since then, and yet there is still so much further to go in creating Dr. King's dream. We often hear the phrase beloved community spoken of in Unitarian Universalist circles, but what does it actually mean for our faith? What does it mean for our congregation? Where does it come from, and why do we strive for it? Well, amazingly enough, it was actually a Unitarian philosopher and professor who first coined the term in the very early 1900s. Josiah Royce from Grass Valley, California, along with 68 other pacifists, founded the Fellowship of Reconciliation at the outbreak of World War I. Dr. King later became a member of that fellowship. King promoted the term beloved community by using it with more explicit meaning and as an aspirational goal for society. It was not meant as a lofty, rapturous idea like a blissful afterlife in heaven where we would all get along with each other. No, MLK meant it as an achievable vision for people committed to and trained in the principles of nonviolence as inspired by Mahatma Gandhi. In his 1966 speech, Nonviolence, the Only Road to Freedom, Dr. King said, "Our goal is to create a beloved community, and this will require a qualitative change in our souls, as well as a quantitative change in our lives." For Dr. King, beloved community was a society based on justice, equal opportunity, and a love for our fellow human beings. It was a society in which human decency would not allow poverty, not allow hunger, not allow homelessness. Beloved community would not condone racism or any forms of discrimination, bigotry, or prejudice. It would be an economically and socially inclusive society, a culture that gave all an equal opportunity at dignity, human rights, and a worthy life. In order to achieve such a community, civil rights leaders at the time studied the Bible, Aristotle, Gandhi, and Thoreau, amongst others, to internalize ways of being that would support this. Congressman John Lewis remembers wondering, "What if the beloved community was already a reality? What if we just had to embody it until everyone else could see it?" He and King realized that they had to live as if. They had to live as if it already existed. They studied and taught each other the ways of nonviolence, peace, and love. They practiced recognizing the spark of the divine in everyone. They encouraged each other to never give up on anyone, even the haters. As Gandhi famously said, "Hate the sin, love the sinner." So, as we face Inauguration Week, Dr. King's vision seems more important than ever. To be advocates of and embody nonviolent action for equality, justice, and dignity for all. Well, it not only aligns us with our 7 Unitarian Universalist principles, but it re-energizes Dr. King's dream of beloved community. It gives us a prophetic vision to live into now. Today would have been Martin Luther King Jr.'s 88th birthday. to honor him, to pay a tribute to him, I'm going to invite us today to be the love. To be the love that is needed to fulfill his vision of beloved community. To be the love that is so necessary in our world to counter all the hate. To be the love that puts the good of the collective whole before that of the individual, so we may indeed pursue Dr. King's dream. King spoke about the goal of agape love. Agape love is a love that does not discriminate between worthy and unworthy people. Agape love, he said, makes no distinction between a friend and enemy. It is directed toward both. Agape is love seeking to preserve and create community. He never ceased to insist that justice and love is the birthright of all people. In speaking about the larger nonviolent movement which they were building after the Montgomery bus boycotts, Dr. King said, "The end is reconciliation. The end is redemption. The end is the creation of beloved community. It is this type of spirit and this type of love that can transform opponents into friends. It is this love which will bring about miracles in the hearts of men," he said. This end goal of reconciliation and redemption that King envisions is no small feat. It involves loving your enemies. It involves separating the action from the doer. For example, Dr. King abhorred segregation, but he insisted on loving the segregationist. What kind of courage and love is that? Wow, right? How can we embody that today when we are faced with people who do hateful things? I wrestle every day with my anger, distrust, and fear of what I see emerging in this new administration. And I struggle with the contrast between this and the call to love all. I hear the call from our faith to do so. I hear the call of past and present civil rights leaders urging us to embody love in the face of hate. But it's hard. Goodness, it's hard. So what are other examples of Dr. King's call for nonviolent reconciliation and redemption? As I understand it, it means seeking to understand, not just retaliate. It means listening, not just protesting. It means befriending the enemy, trying to make a connection with the opposing side in an attempt to find our joint humanity. It's so counter to much of what our reactive, posturing, righteous society currently endorses. And yet, the question is, should we wage war or bring peace? These are hard questions. This is hard, hard work. I'm so glad we're holding a workshop here in 2 weeks focusing on bridging political divisions to understand and communicate with one another better, because I believe we can use all the tools we can get now. So I take comfort from King's encouragement to work on our empathy. I take comfort and inspiration from Dr. King's call to grow our compassion for ourselves and others, to fortify our love, so that we have the strength to be the love. When I can stretch into a better version of myself, it's much more likely that I can at least attempt to approach conflict from a nonviolent perspective. Nonviolent in thought, nonviolent in word, and nonviolent in deed. A funny thing happened. Just as I was writing this section of my sermon, I was right in the flow, inspired by Dr. King's message, and just then, in the middle of a sentence, a large, loud crow landed on my balcony right outside my office, maybe 6 feet away from me. It squawked obnoxiously, loudly disturbing my thoughts. Caw! 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 Now, the tradition in my family is to respond loudly back to crows by clapping and making a loud noise to scare them away. I did this instinctively, but the crow didn't budge. It just puffed up its wings and stared at me, seemingly growing bigger and more obnoxious. Caw! 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 So then I decided to try a bit of the medicine I'm writing about, Dr. King's nonviolent approach. I wished the crow peace and marveled at its shiny black wings, trying to appreciate its inherent beauty and dignity. Now, I don't know if this would have happened anyway, but the crow stopped puffing itself up, retracted its wings, and within an instant became quiet, and then flew away. It was a marvelous metaphor for what Dr. King is asking us to do. In his first book, Stride for Freedom, Dr. King laid out his 6 principles of nonviolence. He challenged us that, 1, nonviolence is a way of life for courageous people. It is active, nonviolent resistance to evil. 2, nonviolence seeks to win friendship and understanding. And 3, to defeat injustice, not people. King's approach recognized that hurt people hurt people. Evildoers are also victims and are not simply evil beings. 4, nonviolence holds that suffering can educate and transform and accept suffering because it can be redemptive. 5, nonviolence chooses love instead of hate. And finally, 6, nonviolence believes that the universe is on the side of justice, that justice will eventually win. Now, these are demanding principles, especially those that call us to make friends of our enemies and accept suffering with the knowledge that suffering brings learning and possible transformation. In fact, I wonder if Dr. King's dream of beloved community is too big a stretch for us at this time. But then again, it was a huge stretch in the 1960s. And perhaps it will always be a stretch. Humans are complex beings, after all. Perhaps we must do what civil rights leaders were calling us to do, to live as if beloved community already exists. I think that's why beloved community is such an important concept for Unitarian Universalists. It is perhaps our essential spiritual path. It's what we aspire to and work towards within and beyond our walls, because if we are a religion focused on ethical living and right action, defending the inherent worth and dignity of all, then surely creating the beloved community is our goal, right? Right? And if we are to go out and share this dream, which many of us are going to be doing this week, then surely we should be practiced at a noble attempt to live it right here at CVUUF. Yet even this community, our beautiful UU community, struggles to live truly embodying King's ideals. Excuse me. We get close, but we are human and sometimes fall short. Nevertheless, because of our UU principles and values, if there's any way we should be able to create beloved community, it's right here at the Conejo Valley Unitarian Universalist Fellowship. Don't you think?
Yep.
Don't you think?
Yes.
So what does it take for us to live out this dream right here? To be the love that's needed for beloved community to flourish? Well, first of all, I invite you to join me in setting aside petty disagreements and complaints. I'm sure they'll occur, but can we set them aside a little more quickly and move on, please? Because, my friends, there's a much bigger, more urgent picture at play here. We're committed to a higher vision of creating more love in this community and beyond. And that's vital and demanding work, and we need all of our strength. So let's examine our actions and words and check whether they're coming from love or from wounding. Are our intentions inspired by a desire for reconciliation? Are we bringing more understanding and compassion to a situation? Could we be more loving towards one another and aim for healing over discord? If Dr. King, who really wanted to be a Unitarian Universalist, were here, he would ask us to truly embrace people of all socioeconomic backgrounds, all races, all genders, all types of intellect and age. Embrace every human being, seeing their inherent worth and dignity, their sacred spark. And then I think he would ask us to channel our anger at the injustices in our government, this country, and the world into nonviolent action. Not just being angry and demonstrating, which is good and appropriate, but also seeking to stand courageously in the face of injustice with peace and love. Nonviolence of heart, mind, and body is the key to MLK's vision of beloved community. The African-American feminist poet and activist Bell Hooks says that creating a culture of love is the most powerful antidote to the politics of domination. She says cultivating the mind of love is so crucial. When love is the ground of our being, a love ethic shapes our participation in politics. To work for peace and justice, she says, we begin with the individual practice of love because it is there that we can experience firsthand love's transformative power. Love is not weak, my friends. Love is stronger and more whole than any other emotion. Love is powerfully courageous and contagious. Love knits the broken strands of our world together. And that's the kind of love that Dr. King and Bell Hooks are calling on us to embody. That's the kind of love they are asking us to exemplify. That's the kind of love I see as my life's passion, my life's purpose. How about you?
Yes.
Yes. 2 months ago, I was invited by the Conejo Valley Interfaith Community to give a speech at the annual Interfaith Thanksgiving service. Several of us were asked to give our own I Have a Dream speech in honor of Dr. King. The service was held at St. Jude's Catholic Church in Westlake Village, and over 800 people showed up. It was humbling to be there and awe-inspiring. It began with a Muslim call to prayer and included a Jewish cantor leading us in Hebrew songs. Many others of diverse traditions shared their hopes and dreams for inclusivity and open-mindedness. I know some of you here were in attendance there that night. But in tribute to the inspiration of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., I thought I would share my speech with you today. I have a dream of a beloved world community. A community in which we seek less to dominate one another and more to listen, to understand, and to cooperate. I have a dream that people of all colors, cultures, religions, and genders will sit together in one giant circle of humanity, that we will hold hands and feel the warmth of our best selves bolting through our beings, connecting us to a current of unity. That we will hold hands as we seek to uncover our core commonalities, our parallel problems. That we will hold hands to discover our precious similarities and marvel with joy and laughter at our differences. We are called to see that which unites us as human beings. We are called to seek that which opens our hearts to one another, that which expresses the shared core values we are taught in our diverse scriptures. In all of our religions, there is one indisputable, inarguable word that binds us all. Do you know what that word is? That word is love. We are called to love. It is not an easy path, but most noble things are not. We must strive to love. Love like the world depends on it, because it does. Love because the stranger becomes the familiar, because they will. Love because it is the only reply to indifference, the only answer to hate. Love because its energy unites us in compassionate action. I have a dream that joined in love, standing on the side of love, we will awaken to see our paths are more alike than different, more similar than at odds. Only then, as Martin Luther King Jr. said, will we know that our freedom is inextricably bound to one another's, that we are free at last. Amen. So I invite us to ask ourselves a simple question. As we pursue the dream of beloved community, are our actions and words coming from love or from fear? If they're motivated by fear or loathing, how might we honor the courage of Dr. King and try to transform them? I invite us to call each other forth, to challenge one another, to embody beloved community, to live from love. I call on us, my friends, to be the love. It's not easy, I know, but it's an ideal worth striving for. It's likely to be an imperfect experiment, just as Esalen was. So we need to be forgiving and compassionate when we fail, and we will fail along the way. But showing empathy for our failures is another way of being radically loving. So I invite you here to join me at CVUUF in a vision of a multiracial, multicultural, multi-class, multi-religious, multi-generational community where love and justice come first. A community in which we strive more to be kind than to be right. A community in which we seek to understand rather than ascribe blame. A community in which we listen and build bridges rather than complain and harm what is good. A community in which we help one another. A community of compassionate hearts, open minds, and willing hands. A community of love. A beloved community. Will you join me in this experiment? Yes. Of non-violent, loving behavior? Can we please remind one another when we fall short that our mission is to love more and to be the change we wish to see in the world, can we?
Yes.
Can we act as if beloved community already exists?
Yes.
We owe it to Dr. King on this anniversary of his birth. We owe it to one another. We owe it to our country at this challenging time. Tomorrow, our National Unitarian Universalist campaign, Standing on the Side of Love, begins its 30 Days of Love program. I plan to participate, and I hope you will too. You can find more information about it online and at our CVUUF social justice page. My goal is to report back to you at the worship service on February 12th, towards the end of these 30 days. My commitment is to find some moment each day to actively choose love over an instinctive reaction. To find moments in each day to be the love in a situation. I invite you all to join me in that endeavor. Let's compare notes, see how it's going. Let's build the love in this community so that it overflows into the communities around us, so that people start to know us as the love people. Yes? Are you game? Let's be the place where people can find acceptance, inclusivity, love, justice, well, and above all, love. This is my dream. Will you join me? Are you in?
Yes.
All right, may it be so. Amen. Thank you.